الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال الله عز وجل يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الكيس من دان نفسه وعمل لما بعد الموت والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواها وتمنى على الله أو كما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and elders and mothers and sisters and youngsters and friends, I've been given a topic about which I hope I am very enthusiastic. This is a topic I, though on one hand, was hoping that we could address the importance of the month of Ramadan and in building an attachment and a connection, a bond with the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially during this month. But hopefully I'll be able to kill two birds with one stone, because the topic I've been given, if I am able to do justice in addressing the issue at hand, then we should be able to cover a little bit of that as well. If a person fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that he fears his death and everything that is going to occur and transpire in a person after he leaves this world, then for him Ramadan, Sha'ban, Muharram, Safar, they should all be the same, because he wants to live every moment of his life, not one of the 12 months alone, but every single moment in the life of this believer is one in which he is drawing closer to Allah and closer to the gardens of Jannah, and he continues to draw further away from the fire of Shaitan, from the fire of Jahannam and the tricks, the talabis of Shaitan. So the theme of discussion, we just had it up here for a few seconds. Anyhow, the purpose of our lives. Though this theme, this topic can be addressed from so many different angles, let me just share with you an idea. Let me just share with you a few of the traditions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in regards to where a person goes after he leaves this world. Yes, we came, whether we liked it or not, we came into this world and now we're here. And as long as we're here, what is it that we're expected to do? Because after this, we have a very great long journey, a very great difficult pass in front of us. If a person makes the best of the time that he had in this world, then everything which is yet to come is going to be very blissful and easy for him. But on the other hand, if a person doesn't know the purpose of his life, he chooses to live his life according to his own lusts, according to his or her own desires and whims. But unfortunately, this person has been misguided. This person doesn't know where he was going. This person forgot that we were only going to live once. And this person was heedless and unmindful of the fact that once we leave this world, that's when our eyes will actually open. Now it seems like we may be wide awake, but as a matter of fact, when we leave this world, when we're put inside of the graves, is when our eyes will actually open and reality will finally check in. So what is it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has defined to us a man who is wise and shrewd. Not a person that you and I consider wise and shrewd. Your definition of a person that is wise may be one. My definition may be another. And according to some great, some thinker, some maker, some shaker, it may be another. According to the people of this generation, a wise and shrewd man may be one. But then there is the definition of a wise and shrewd person by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what is it? Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'da al-maut. Wal-ajizu man atba'a nafsahu hawaha wa tamanna ala Allah. This is the hadith that I mentioned at the very beginning. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that a wise and shrewd person is he who checks himself, he who takes himself into account, and this person prepares for that which is in the life hereafter. That is the purpose of our life in this world. Not that we prepare for this world. Ali radiallahu anhu used to say, وَلِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا بَنُونَ فَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. There are people who run after, there are people who toil so hard, there are people who make outright efforts for this dunya, and then there are those who make the same efforts. They exert themselves not for the things of this world, not for this temporary abode, not for this transitory station that Allah has given to us as a test, as a trial and tribulation, but for the life hereafter that knows no end. It will never come to an end. It will go on and on. فَإِنَّ الْيَوْمَ عَمَلٌ بِلَا حِسَابٌ وَإِنَّ الْغَدَ حِسَابٌ بِلَا عَمَلٌ. Today you do what you want. Nobody's going to investigate. Nobody's going to interrogate. Nobody's going to put you to test as to why did you do this and why did you do that. Today we do deeds, be it good deeds or evil deeds. There's no interrogation. Tomorrow, there will be no more opportunity to do those deeds. It will be only interrogation. How much did we understand and appreciate the purpose of our lives while we were still in this earthly abode? Everything that is waiting for us in the life hereafter. I would never in 25, 30 minutes be able to explain to us, give us even a glimpse of what is to occur in the life hereafter. But I will try to the best of my ability, just give us an understanding that this life that we're living now is no joke. That person was defined a wise and shrewd man by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who prepared for the life hereafter. There's absolutely no mention of making any mansion for himself in this world. It is all pertaining to the life that awaits every single one of us in the hereafter. وَالْعَاجِزُ Who is the weak and incapable one then? مَنْ أَتْبَعَ نَفْسَهُ هَوَاهَا He continues, she continues to live his life or her life according to his own desires and whims, his own lusts. He just continues fulfilling his needs, his wants, and everything else. وَتَمَنَّى عَلَى اللَّهِ And this person says, it's okay, Allah is most forgiving. Allah is oft forgiving, most merciful. Rasulullah ﷺ deems this person a very weak and incapable one. So what is the comparison of this dunya to the next? This life that we're living now compared to the next. The Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said, Wallahi, the Prophet ﷺ need not take any oath on anything. He is asdaqul qa'ilin after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every word of his is inspired from above the heavens. But to make us understand the importance and the integrity of what he's about to tell us. Wallahi, I swear by Allah. Mad dunya fil akhirah illa mithlu ma yaj'alu ahadukum isba'ahu hadhihi fil yammi falyanzur ahadukum bima tarji'. What is it? This dunya compared to the next life? It is like a person dipping his finger inside of the ocean. And you can imagine there isn't a volume of water, literally. It's only a little bit of moisture that remains on his finger when he lifts his finger. That is the dunya compared to the entire ocean, which is the akhirah. This is the example the Rasulullah ﷺ has given. This life that we're living now, it's a mere deception. It's a mirage. You see it from a distance and it looks very, very nice. But once you come to it, you come to realize, and then by then it's too late. We never turn to Allah before we return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We realize then that it's too late. So what happens when a person leaves this world? A person is placed inside of the grave. And Uthman radiallahu anhu was a great sahabi. We have no time. Time is very limited to be able to tell you the accolades of Uthman radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had married him to his daughter radiallahu anha. And when she met her end during the time of Badr, there was great news and there was very sad, tragic news at the same time. When Ruqayya radiallahu anha left the world, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I will give Ummi Kulthum to Uthman. And if I had 100 daughters, I would have given every one of them to Uthman. This man, he walks by the grave. And Hani, who is his free slave, says, when Uthman radiallahu anhu would pass by the grave, he would stand at the graveyard and he would cry. He would cry until his beard would become wet. A man who has been promised such abode in the life hereafter by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let alone anything else, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar fil Jannah, Uthman fil Jannah, Ali fil Jannah, Sa'ad, Zubair, Talha, Abu Ubaid, Sa'id. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had promised all of them Jannah in this very world. And here he is, crying to the extent that his beard becomes wet with tears out of the fear of the punishment of the grave. Wallahi, if I could cry one tear out of the same fear, Allahu Akbar, I don't know how ecstatic this would be for me. Here he is crying to the extent that his beard is wet with tears. So he says, the people used to ask him, Oh Uthman, تُذْكَرُ الْجَنَّةُ وَالنَّارُ فَلَا تَبْكِي وَتَبْكِي مِنْ هَذَا People talk about Jannah before you, people talk about Jahannam in front of you. You don't cry, yet when you come in front of the grave, this is your condition. He says, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, إِنَّ الْقَبْرَ أَوَّلُ مَنْزِلٍ مِّن مَنَازِلِ الْآخِرَةِ, that the grave is the first of the many stages of the life hereafter. فَإِنَّ جَا مِنْهُ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَيْسَرُ مِنْ, if a person has been granted security and salvation in the grave, from the punishment of the grave, and wallahi, every single one of us here should make it a practice of reciting Suratul Mulk every single night. The amount of time that we've learned to give, unfortunately, to everything else, Allah alone knows if that will be for us or against us on the day of Qiyamah. We can take 5 to 10 minutes out. Make it a practice every night to recite Suratul Mulk, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has promised us that this will be a means of a person's security from the punishment in the grave. So Uthman radiallahu anhu says, a person who has attained security from the punishment of the grave, everything which is to come afterwards is going to be very easy for him. فَإِن لَمْ يَنْجُ مِنْ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَشَدُّ مِنْ, if he did not get security from the punishment of the grave, then everything which awaits him, unfortunately, is only worse. And then he says that the Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said, مَا رَأَيْتُ مَنْظَرًا قَطُّ إِلَّا وَالْقَبْرُ أَفْضَعُ مِنْ, I have never in my life seen a scenario, a scene, witnessed anything, a scene more terrifying and horrifying than the punishment of the grave, said the Prophet ﷺ. How much you and I will have to prepare, and when? While we're still in this world. If we did not understand the purpose of our lives, all of this is a reality. All of this is going to happen, and wallahi it's going to happen. Because Allah said it's going to happen. Because the Prophet ﷺ said it's going to happen. In one hadith, Abu Sa'id radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet ﷺ came to his place of worship. دَخَلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مُصَلَّاهُ فَرَآ نَاسًا كَأَنَّهُمْ يَكْتَشِرُونَ, he saw that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were perhaps busy having a nice discussion. They laughed to the extent that their teeth, molars had become visible. So the Prophet ﷺ sees them in this condition. You can imagine when I laugh, I can laugh at times, wallahi, I'll roll. He's only seen the molar teeth of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and immediately diverts the attention of these illustrious companions. These are Sahaba, these are not you and me. These are the companions of Rasulullah. But this is the condition that he finds them in. Immediately does he tell them, أَمَا إِنَّكُمْ لَوْ أَكْثَرْتُمْ ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّاتِ لَشَغْلَكُمْ عَمَّا أَرَى الْمَوْتِ, wallahi, if I knew, if you people would keep yourselves occupied and busy with the mention of that which destroys and crushes all pleasures, i.e. death, then I would not have found you people in this condition. What condition? Only their molar teeth had become visible. فَأَكْثِرُوا مِنْ ذِكْرِ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّاتِ, so as often as possible, as frequently as possible, remember that which destroys all pleasures and crushes all pleasures. فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَأْتِي عَلَى الْقَبْرِ يَوْمٌ إِلَّا تَكَلَّمَ فَيَقُولُ, there isn't a day or a night that passes except that the grave addresses. Try to understand that this isn't physics, this is metaphysics. The grave addresses and says, أَنَا بَيْتُ الْغُرْبَةِ وَأَنَا بَيْتُ الْوَحْدَةِ وَأَنَا بَيْتُ التُّرَابِ وَأَنَا بَيْتُ الدُّودِ, I am a house of exile, says the grave. I'm a house of loneliness. I'm a house of dust, and I'm a house of worms. فَإِذَا دُفِنَ الْعَبْدُ الْمُؤْمِنِ, so when that God-fearing, righteous, pious slave of Allah is buried therein, a man who understood the purpose of his life, a woman who lived her life in accordance to the commandments of Allah and the ways of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ وَأَصْحَابِي, this person is buried therein. He is addressed by the grave, O Allah, make us amongst them. The grave says to this person, Marhaban wa ahla. English can't do justice in translating this welcome. Let me just tell you, the grave says welcome in the best manner possible, with the greatest words. Welcome to you, welcome. Amma an kunta la ahabba man yamshi ala dhahri ilayhi. Don't you know, my friend, that of all the people, the billions that used to walk on me, the earth, you are the most beloved to me. فَإِذَا وَلِّيْتُكَ الْيَوْمِ, وَصِرْتَ إِلَيَّ فَسَتَرَى صَنِيعِي بِكَ. And today when you've been put into my custody, you will now witness and see what hospitality I have to present to you. And the level of hospitality then is which is extended to this person. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, وَيَتَّسِعُ لَهُ مَدَّ بَصَرِهِ وَيُفْتَحُ لَهُ بَابٌ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Then for this person, his grave is opened as far as his eyes can see. He is made to don the apparel and the garments of the people of Jannah. He is made to lie on that which the people of Jannah will recline on in Jannah. And then this person, he is given these glad tidings, a gate to Jannah is opened up for him on one hand. And on the other hand, وَإِذَا دُبْفِنَ الْعَبْدُ الْفَاجِرُ أَوْ الْكَافِرُ. An immoral slave of Allah, someone who transgressed, somebody who rebelled, somebody who was of this false notion, I'm only going to live in this dunya and that's it. Like we used to say, or we used to hear, وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. You only live once. That's what this person used to think. But now that this person has been placed inside, 6 feet under the ground, down, all by himself, does he only come to realize, perhaps this wasn't a joke. So what happens? The grave then addresses this person, لا مرحباً ولا أهلا. You are not welcomed at all. You are the most unwelcome for of all people that walked on the earth. Of all the billions that walked over me, you are the most abhorred and hated of every single one of them to me. Now that you wretched one, have been put, oh you wicked and evil one, you've been put in my custody. How dare you transgress against my Allah? Says the earth to this person who was left by his lonesome. There's nobody there for him. Absolutely by himself. This person is told, you watch exactly how I treat you now. How dare you rebel against Allah? You knew it was Salah time. You knew that this is what Allah wanted you to do. Yet you used to say that Allah is oft forgiving, most merciful. Now that you've been put in my custody, it's up to me to treat you the way I like. Because Allah has given me this authority. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then says, فَتَخْتَلِفَ أَضْلَاعُ فَيَلْتَقِمُ عَلَيْهِ وَيَلْتَقِيَ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى تَخْتَلِفَ أَضْلَاعُ. So then the grave starts to close in on this person. To what extent? That the ribs of one side of his cage, they penetrate and intermingle into the ribs of the other side. And the Prophet ﷺ, this is exactly what he did with his fingers. He demonstrated this, illustrated with his Mubarak fingers to the Sahaba to make them understand that the grave is no joke, that you're living in this world thinking you're only going to live once, you're out of your mind. This is a reality and this is going to happen. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَيُقَيِّدُ اللَّهُ لَهُ سَبْعِينَ ثِنِّينَ لَوْ أَنَّ وَاحِدًا مِّنْهُمْ نَفَخَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَا أَنْبَتَتْ شَيْئًا مَّا بَقِيَتِ الدُّنْيَا. And then 70 serpents are let loose upon this person and they will continue to bite him and lacerate him, eat out his flesh and his skin until the day of Qiyamah. If a single one of them were to spurt its venom on this earth, I don't say this. Science might not be able to prove this to you because this is out of this world. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if only one of them were to spurt its venom, not a single blade of grass would grow till the day of Qiyamah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam then concludes, إِنَّ الْقَبْرَ رَوْضَةٌ مِّن رِيَاضِ الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ حُفْرَةً مِّن حُفَرِ النَّارِ. That a grave could be for some a garden from the many, many gardens of Jannah. Oh Allah, make it for us as such. Or it could be a pit from the many pits and ditches of Jahannam. It isn't a joke. Wallahi, this is serious. It isn't just about Ramadan. Just 10 days from now. Yes, we make every effort during the month of Ramadan. This is a lifelong commitment. It isn't a conference that we came to. This is a commitment with Allah. This is a pledge with Allah. Because once we leave this world, oh, we'll be left by ourselves. All our acquaintances, all of our family members. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِذَا وُضِعَ الْعَبْدُ فِي قَبْرِهِ. When this slave of Allah is placed inside of this grave, وَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُ أَصْحَابُهُ. All of those who had come to bid him literally the last farewell. This is the last time they would come to say bye. They bury him inside and they begin to walk. وَإِنَّهُ لَيَسْمَعُ قَرَعًا يَعَانِهِمْ The Prophet ﷺ gives us, depicts this amazing scenario. Rasulullah ﷺ said, as they start to walk, the slapping of their sandals can be heard by this person. Imagine, this is the last time you will be able to hear from those that were with you in this world. Oh, they had your back. Oh, they were with you through thick and thin. Oh, you used to call them, they were there. You holler at them, they'll be there for you. Mind you, once they start to walk away, we're left all by our lonesome. So then what happens? Rasulullah ﷺ says, أَتَاهُ مَلَكًا Then two angels that have been deputed by Allah come to him. فَيُقْعِدَانِهِ فَيَقُولَانِ So they make him sit up. Let the interrogation begin. They say, مَا كُنْتَ تَقُولُ فِي هَذَا الرَّجُلِ لِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ What did you, O man, used to say about Muhammadur Rasulullah صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ So if it's a believer, O Allah, let us die believers. This person then says, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّهُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ What do you have? I live my whole life the way Allah wants.
said, to make us appreciate that which lies in the life hereafter. Don't write any red card, please. Don't give me no time. May Allah bless you. He says, كيف أنعم وصاحب القرن قد التقم القرن واستمع الأذن متى يؤمر بالنفخ فينفخ فكأن ذلك الثقل على أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet says, how is it possible for me to enjoy my life and live at ease when the one who has been appointed by Allah to hold the trumpet is holding it in its mouth and paying very close attention to the order of Allah, lest Allah may order me at this moment in time to blow and the trumpet sounds and the skies will clash and rent asunder, the seas will be set ablaze, the stars lose their brightness. How is it that Muhammad can live his life, alayhi afdalu salawatu min Allah wa taslimat, in ease and in joy and in happiness, when this is the condition of Israfil alayhi salam? The Sahaba heard this, they were blown away. فَكَأَنَّ ذَلِكَ ثَقُلَ عَلَيْهِمْ. They said, Ya Rasulullah, oh my goodness, if you are in this condition, what have we to stand in front of Allah? When Ali radiallahu anhu was on the verge of leaving this world, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu says, I saw him, or was it Sa'id radiallahu anhu, who narrates to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, when he requested him to give him a description of Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, I used to see Ali al-Murtada radiallahu anhu, he would hold his beard, and he would admonish himself, a man who was promised not only Jannah, and not only a palace in Jannah, but a palace in Jannah, directly opposite the palace of Rasulullah. And here he is telling himself, Ya Ali, Ya Ali, Ya Ali, what have you done? There's a very great long journey that lies ahead of you. A very long journey for which the preparations that you have made are very little. If Ali radiallahu anhu's preparations he considers little, what have you and I done to prepare for the life hereafter? How the Sahaba radiallahu anhu took this? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consoles them and comforts them. قُولُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلَ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. Just say, O my companions, that Allah is sufficient for us and He is the best of those who protect. What is going to happen when we leave this world? On one occasion, the hadith of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, Aisha radiallahu anha says, I was with His Highness alayhi salatu wasalam, and he finished praying his salah, and I wanted to listen to what dua he made after his salah. Allahu Akbar, who? Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Some said, بَلَغَ الْعُلَى بِكَمَالِهِ كَشَفَ الدُّجَى بِجَمَالِهِ حَسُنَ جَمِيعُ خِصَالِهِ صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. Imam Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu said, he said, what was Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu share? Allahu Akbar, about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Anyways, others said, Ya Sahib al-Jamal wa Ya Sayyid al-Bashar, min wajhika al-Muniri laqad nubira al-Qamar, la yumkinu al-Thana'a kama kana haqqahu, ba'da s-khudab huzul kutuhi qissah mukhtasar. Others said, Allamu Busiri, amin tadakuri jiranin bidhi salami, mazajta dam'an jara min muqlatin bidami, amhabbatin rihu min tilqai kazimatin, wa awmad al-barqu fi al-zalmai min idhumi, famali aynayka in qultakfu fahamata, wa mali qalbika in qulta astafiq. يهمي أيحسب الصب أن الحب منكتم ما بين منسجم منه ومضطرم مولا يا صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. Making dua after his salah. اللهم حاسبني حسابا يسيرا. Oh Allah, make my interrogation and questioning on the day of Qiyamah an easy one. Aisha radiallahu anha says, فلما انصرف قلت, he finishes salah and I said, Ya Nabi Allah, ma al-hisabu al-yaseer? What's the definition of an easy reckoning? You're asking Allah for an easy reckoning. What do you and I have to ask Allah for? She says, ma al-hisabu al-yaseer? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, an yunzara fi kitabihi fa yatajawazu anhu. That a person's book of deeds be looked into and he be forgiven. You've got nothing to worry about, move on. Go on. فإنه من نوقش الحساب يومئذ يا عائشة هلك. Because oh Aisha, anybody who's interrogated on that day will be destroyed and ruined. Oh Allah, save us. Imagine the Prophet ﷺ's preparation for that which is haq. It is true. It is going to happen. Every single one of us will have to be made to undergo all of these stages. We will stand in front of Allah. And everyone will have to stand in front of Allah. One Sahabi radiallahu anhu says, I asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how would it be, مَنْ يَقْوَى عَلَى الْقِيَامِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الَّذِي قَالَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ He says, I was curious and I asked the Prophet ﷺ, O Prophet of Allah, who will have the courage and the audacity to stand in front of Allah, about which Allah says in the Holy Quran, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ A day when all of mankind, from the beginning till the end, will be made to stand in front of Allah, if only time permitted. Everyone will be made to stand in front of Allah on that day. He says, I ask Ya Rasulullah, how will it be possible? Who will it be possible for to stand in front of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again comforted him and said, يَتَخَفَّفُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِ Allah will make it very easy for a believer, just as the period of time that it takes him to perform two rakats of salah. Allah will make it very easy. Oh Allah, make it easy for us. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then describes the condition of the people on the Day of Judgment. And he is reported to have said that the people will be in three classes on the Day of Qiyamah. ثَلَاثَةُ أَصْنَافُ صِنْفٌ مُشَاتٌ وَصِنْفٌ رُكْبَانٌ وَصِنْفٌ مُشَاتٌ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ There will be those who are walking, and then there will be those who are riding, and then there will be those who will be made to walk on their faces. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, كَيْفَ يَنْشُونَ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ How would it be possible for these people to walk on their faces? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, إِنَّ الَّذِي قَادِرٌ The one who was able to make them walk on their feet in this world is definitely able to make them walk on their faces on that day. أَمَا إِنَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ بِوُجُوهِهِمْ كُلَّ عَدَبٍ وَشَوْكَةٍ You will see on that day how every effort will be made by these same people to try and avoid every single obstacle and every single thorn and everything that comes in the way of their faces. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. This is a day on which every one of us will stand in front of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا سَيُكَلِّمُهُ رَبُّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ تُرْجُمَانٌ Every one of us will be made to stand in front of Allah, and there will be no need for anyone to interpret what happens and what conversation takes place between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what will this person do? Again, like we used to in this world, to see if we had any backup, had anybody that could come take care of us. فَيَنْظُرَ أَيْمَنَ مِنْ This person will look to his right. فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمَ مِنْ عَمَلِهِ All he will find at his aid and assistance will be his deeds, be it good or bad. He finds, unfortunately, nobody here. فَيَنْظُرَ أَشْأَمَ مِنْ He looks to his left. وَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمَ مِنْ عَمَلِهِ All he finds is his deeds. فَيَنْظُرَ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا النَّارَ تِلْقَاءَ وَجِهِ He looks ahead of himself. He finds nothing but the fire of Jahannam blazing before his eyes. The Prophet ﷺ warns us, اتَّقُوا النَّارَ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَةٍ Fear Allah, fear Allah, fear Allah. Understand why Allah brought us into this world. Appreciate and acknowledge the purpose of the life of a believer. We're not here for a few days to merry make and enjoy. Allah wants us to live the way He wants us to live. Allah gave us an example of life, the most auspicious, noble example, whose every word and way, tradition and style was inspired from above the heavens. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran, His was the example, the best of all examples, the example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose as an example for every one of us to come until the day of Qiyamah, a guide, the likes of which the world had never seen. It would never be rivaled, it would never be challenged. Allah bless this Ummah with the Holy Quran. And when we choose to live our lives on that note and in that manner, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, after we've been shaken a little bit now, he says, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ حَوْضًا وَإِنَّهُمْ يَتَبَاعُونَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَكْثَرُ وَارِدًا وَإِنِّي أَرْجُو أَنْ أَكُونَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ وَارِدًا That every prophet on the day of Qiyamah will have their own pond. And I too will have my own pond, Al-Kawfa. And every prophet will try to pride themselves over the other prophets to see which one of their ponds will be the most attended to by their followers. He says, I have hope that mine will be most attended by my followers. He says, Hawdi Masiratu Shahr. Now let me describe to you what this pond, we haven't even made it to the gardens of Jannah. We're just about to get there, inshallah. So the Prophet ﷺ describes it. Hawdi Masiratu Shahr. How big is this pond, Al-Kawthar, Alladhi A'taka Rabbuk, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the Prophet ﷺ with, for us! For those who choose to live like him, for those who know and understand the purpose of their lives, its distance is 1 month. A journey of 1 month will it take a person to go from one side to the other side. وَزَوَيَهُ سَوَى. All of its sides are equal. وَمَاءُهُ أَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْوَرَقِ. The whiteness of the water of my pond is greater than that of silver. وَرِيحُهُ أَطْيَبُ مِنَ الْمِسْكِ. And its fragrance is more delightful than that of musk. وَكِزَانُهُ كَنُجُومِ السَّمَاءِ. And its cups and its goblets are more than the stars in the sky. And I promise you, مَنْ شَرِبَ مِنْهُ فَلَا يَذْمَأُ بَعْدَهُ أَبَدًا. Whoever drinks from my pond, never again will they feel thirsty. And then we move forward. We have yet to enter Allah's only promise. Listen, Hadith Qudsi. أَعْدَتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ. I have prepared for you, O my righteous slaves. It's only 60 or 70 years. Just live the way I want you to live. Leave the trends, leave the customs, leave the rituals. We don't look for rituality here. We look for spirituality. We're not here in this conference for information. We're here for transformation. Do what Allah wants you to do. Allah says, I have prepared for my righteous slaves that which no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no mind has ever fathomed or comprehended. And if you like, then read what Allah says in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. There isn't a soul in this world who knows that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept hidden for his righteous believers. And then we advance and we come closer. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is only inspiring us and encouraging us. This is what I have waiting for you. Why run after the petty, materialistic gains of this world when I have وَلَقَابُ قَوْسِ أَحَدِكُمْ فِي الْجَنَّةِ خَيْرٌ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. The hadith of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, that the amount of space that a whip occupies in paradise is greater than the world and what it contains. وَلَوْ أَنَّ امْرَأَةً مِّن نِسَاءِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ اطَّلَعَتْ فِيهَا لَأَضَاءَتْ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا. If a single woman of the women of Jannah were to just glance into this world, the entire world would be filled with the light from one glance of one of the women in Jannah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wala mawdi'u sawtin fil jannah, wala mawdi'u qadamin fil jannah, khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha." The amount of space that one of your feet occupies in Jannah, wallahi, is greater than the world and whatever it contains. So these people will finally make it inside. Oh Allah, make us amongst those who enter without any reckoning. And then finally, when they come inside, an announcement will be made. A caller will call out, "Yunadi munadin, inna lakum an tasihhu fala tasqamu abada." You people will be in good health. Never in your lives do you even have to entertain the thought of becoming sick again. So wow! We're going to be on vacation for the rest of our lives. Never are we going to become sick. Well, we might become old. Allah will order that an announcement be made. إِنَّ لَكُمْ أَن تَشِبُّوا فَلَا تَطَمُوا أَبَدًا. You will remain young, exuberant, energetic, and full of life. Never will you ever think of attaining old age. I'll never get bored. I'll never get sick. I'll never get old. إِنَّ لَكُمْ أَن تَنَعَمُوا فَلَا تَبْأَسُوا أَبَدًا. I might become bored. Allah will order an announcement be made. It is for you to enjoy the level of enjoyment which this world will fail to produce. Wallahi, this world will never produce what Allah has awaited every one of us in Jannah, inshaAllah. Allah will order an announcement be made that you people will enjoy. Never once will you get bored. So you're going to be here. You're going to be here. What if my visa expires? What if the time that I'm here, it's done? Allah will order an announcement be made. A last final announcement. إِنَّ لَكُمْ أَن تَحْيَوْا فَلَا تَمُوتُوا أَبَدًا. You will live for eternity. Never will you have to die. And finally, and I conclude on this note, give me the red card. First comes the yellow one, then comes the red. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Hadith al-Qudsi, and when the people of Jannah will have settled therein, Allah will ask them. Allah Himself will ask. Allahu Akbar. Imagine having to see Allah, and then imagine having to communicate with Allah. Why run after the things of this world? How do we miss one salah when Allah is going to ask? This is the hadith of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. Wallahi al-azim. I'll show you every one of the hadith if you need proof. Allah will announce, Allahu Akbar. Turiduna shay'an azidukum? O you people of Jannah, do you want anything else? And the people will reply, Alam tubayyid wujuhana? O Allah, have you not made our faces so white and beautiful? The nur on the face of the Jannati will be witnessed from 1,000 years away. O Allah, have you not made us so beautiful? Alam tudkhilna al-jannata wa tunajjina min an-nar? O Allah, did you not save us from the fire of Jahannam and grant us entry into Jannah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, fayukshafu al-hijab. This veil and curtain that will be there will then be removed. And Allah will allow us to witness His countenance. We will then be allowed to see Allah. Every other bounty in Jannah will be forgotten after this. Understand the purpose of your life, the purpose of my life, and work towards acquiring it. Because that which awaits us in the life hereafter is far greater than anything in this world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us.